What's happening? My name is Jeff Klein, and we're here at Nine Lives in Austin, Texas. It's a house that we converted into a home studio environment. We have three friends of ours coming by today. All of them are brass players. We're going to hang out, discuss some experiences that we've had on the road and in the studio, and then we're going to record some music in here. Come check it out.
Inspired you guys to pick up the horn way back when?
Way back when?
Yeah.
Band. Just band? Like band class was cool. I liked it. I went to a middle school in which you had to do every elective. Like every single one of them, no matter what, shop and art and home ec and everything. Like everyone had to try them all. And band stuck because I was in church choir with my whole life. I've been in church choir. And then once it got to a music thing in school, it stuck with me. So I did percussion ensemble and euphonium and stuff. Yep.
Very cool. What about you guys? Same thing?
I was, it was kind of the beginning of actually choosing an instrument to play was band, fourth grade, whatever, you know.
Fourth grade?
Yep, fourth grade. Pick instruments.
That's when you start to play horns, is the fourth grade.
Fourth grade? I started in sixth grade. Am I late?
Yeah, you're late.
Two years behind.
That's one thing I love about people who play brass instruments is that so many actually learn in school. It's just never the case with rock and roll stuff, you know?
That's true.
I think you listen to records and you're like, I want to be that guitar shredder, but we don't, with horns, it doesn't work that way.
Well, yeah. My dad was a trumpet player and a jazz musician, so I had a lot of that. Mm. I was inspired by the time fourth grade came around to know that I didn't want to play trumpet.
Yeah.
I'd already, because my dad didn't kill that shit, but just like I don't know, like I didn't like the way my chops felt. So I knew it wasn't gonna be that.
You knew at 9 years old that you didn't like.
Pretty much,
your chops
like
felt.
I was just like every time I picked it up and was like, no, that's not.
Yeah.
I still feel like that.
Yeah, I tried the saxophone in the sixth grade and felt that way. It was
that
just
way?
Like
yeah.
I didn't like biting it. You have to like bite the saxophone or something.
Yeah.
It shows how much I know. I think. Yeah. Why don't you bite it to get it to play? I don't know.
It's the same beginnings of that.
Yeah.
Do you have any personal like superstitions or anything like rituals you do before you play or record?
Brush
your teeth.
Nope.
Yeah.
Clean it. Clean my horn. Mm-hmm. Just to like wipe it off and start fresh. It feels like brand new car or something.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, not really. Not rituals.
I just show up late.
You just show up late?
And hungry. late, hungry, and upset. Ask if there's coffee. No, I'm just kidding.
That's what he said, basically.
Yeah.
Maybe that's a horn player thing. like, brother? Dad?
What's a high and a low? Professional high and low? Being a musician.
Being a musician?
Yeah.
I mean, the highs are just like,
just one for you. What's a professional high point in your
professional
career?
High point? Seeing the world, just like in continuing to see it and like marking states off of my little list of places, you know. And that's a high. Lows are just like really slogging it, you know, playing in the rain, just like back in the days, like waking up on the floor of sleeping on the floor of a laundry room, waking up cat hair all over my face.
Yeah.
Like that's the low. That's just long.
That was
long
just
ago.
This morning too. Yeah. Thanks, Jeff.
Yeah. Oh, Klein.
That's really good. Classic Klein.
Mm-hmm.
Just weird, I haven't thought about it in a while, but I'll pick one high for now.
That's
which
good.
Was playing Ornette Coleman's music for him. On Ooh. His birthday,
that's,
was a high.
That's amazing. Where was that?
At the Walker Art Center. That was, I don't even know how many years ago. Five, six years ago. Maybe, probably more than that, actually. I don't know. But yeah, that's a high.
Yeah. Any high or low for you?
Dude, so many. So many of both. So many highs, so many lows.
Mm-hmm.
With it, you know, in Edward Sharpe, we have kind of a lot of highs because those shows are really religious for a lot of people, you know?
Yeah.
So it can get. Like really amazing moments can happen, but like not to go into, you know, long stories, but there was one recently that was really cool that, not in that band, but Glenn Hansard came to town, the Irish singer, and I heard he was in LA, and I just hit him up. I was like, but, you know, we should get together. And he's like, oh, I'm playing a gig tonight, you should come down. And the backstory is that growing up there in LA, I would go see the LA Philharmonic when I was like, you know, four, all the way to present day, like periodically. Mm-hmm. And so when Disney Hall was built, that's a place I'd never played. I played most rooms, but, you know, where their house, which is kind of an amazing 360 concert hall. So we played this gig at Largo, and he just wanted me to play on everything. I played through the whole set. It was amazing. And it was a small band. It was just like him and his piano player. He had a bass player. He had Leonard Cohen's lute player and me. And I didn't know a single song. And he was like, man, you got to change your flight and come and play these shows at Disney Hall. The LA Philharmonic was there. Mm-hmm. They were playing the first set. And it's, again, you know, sold out, people in the round, and like some, you know, heroes in the audience, like Beck was there, and David Campbell was a friend of mine, his dad, that was conducting the orchestra. Mm-hmm. Wow. And so I made it through three sets on two nights with, on that stage, not knowing a single song. And it was amazing.
Yeah.
And people awesome. Were tripping, and I was getting praise from people that were like, that I had so much, you know, altitude for. But, you know, when a high for me is when I go into something that I feel like is certain failure, because I'm just so, you know, I can't hang, and then I, like, survive it.
Yeah.
And that's, I come home, that's floating.
Yeah.
You have to, like, leave your body in those moments just to kind of
relax. Mm-hmm. Play.
Any, untap some power that you know you don't have.
Yeah. Yeah. Any lows? Any lows you want to mention? You can abstain, it's okay.
Don't make me think about it.
Yeah. The first Europe tour? Yeah. I'm
there. Can't wait.
Very first
one.
It's
a long story. A lot of details.
Yeah.
Yeah. Lost a lot of good men out there.
So we got Mike Lewis and his saxophone.
Saxophone.
Tenor sax?
Tenor saxophone.
And you play alto sax also.
I do.
And
alto, soprano, and
all the sax.
All of them. Yeah, I don't own all of them, but I presume I could probably
pick them up and figure it out.
Figure it out.
And mic-wise, what do we got going on?
So we've got the Origin up front.
Yeah.
Pretty close on him. And then we've got two other ones, we've got two spirits in Omni, actually.
In Omni, okay.
One kind of in the corner over here, not in the bathroom, but kind of outside of it, and then one even further away over here.
And what's the point of doing that?
So the idea was to kind of mimic the Tony Visconti, David Bowie Heroes vocal trick.
Vocals. Yeah, yeah.
Where they have the further mics kind of gated to where they only trigger or open up whenever you blow real hard.
Awesome. Yeah.
Cool.
Cool. Sounds really interesting. That sounds fun.
Cool.
Yeah. Yeah. Looking forward to it.
Thank you.
Some mistakes you guys see engineers making, like with your horn.
Oof,
you know.
Reframe that question.
Yeah. What's my mistake?
I want to see people making. All our engineer friends are just like, yeah. What?
Don't worry, we'll just name in the Google tag, so it won't come up.
Can you bleep out the names of people
we'll
that were about the
name.
To roll?
Yeah. You don't want to name the person, just what's a common mistake you see someone make with miking your horn?
Miking it too close.
Across the board, miking it too close.
Oh, yeah. That's one.
Yeah.
I think not taking a second to figure out what it's going to be before really getting into the mic setup.
That's more what I was trying to say, I guess.
It's just like, what am I doing? Am I playing quiet? If I'm playing quiet, then pull the mic up. If I'm not playing quiet, or me push the mic back.
Yeah.
Or just like trying to figure out what the song's gonna sound like. Is it supposed to sound real crispy and brassy? Mm. Then that's a different sound than a smoky kind of dark sound. So just figuring out what you're gonna do before getting deep into the weeds of setting things up.
Yeah.
You know, like what am I here for?
Yeah.
I had a guy that used to, made a bunch of records with a cat who used to, stand out in front of me and just have me play for a while, and he would just move around and use his microphone to see what that sounded like.
Wow.
So that he had, like, you know, he'd just move to different areas, like he'd get 6 feet away, mm-hmm. or he'd get like right up close, and he'd get in closer to the stack of the keys or get right on the bell or whatever, and then he would set up like, you know, 3, sometimes 4 mics in different spots just to try to catch those sounds. And then he would explain to me what he was hearing and, like, you know, because I can't hear what he's hearing, you know?
Yeah.
Like, that's the other part, you know, so it's like, you know, I think just taking the time, you know what I mean? If there's a number one mistake or whatever, it's just like being in a big and hurried it. You know what I mean? It's like, just take a
being
minute,
in a hurry.
You know?
That's
try
it,
to,
yeah.
Being too throw and go.
Time is money, you know, so that ends up having weird consequences. Yeah. Of just like moving too quick in general.
Yeah. What was the first time you guys recorded music? Like, the first time I recorded music, I was 14. It was really bad. So what about you? What was your first experience recording?
First experience recording was I was 12. Mm-hmm. I was in sixth grade, and my dad was a musician, so he there was some school project, something or other, where like in a class where like kids either had to write a song or a poem or something like that, you know, and so I opted for a song, and my dad surprised me, and basically like as soon as he found out about the project, then he booked a proper studio with his buddy that, you know, like, so awesome. So I went by myself with my dad, and I don't remember if we used like a Jamie Aversold or something like that for the rhythm section, but wrote a blues song about how I didn't want to do it, and just really like whatever, it was ridiculously embarrassing, and but I mean, also, like, you know, whatever, proper professional studio with my dad helping out, who knew what he was doing, and then so it's like it came in and it's like it sounded as good as that was gonna sound, like really pristine.
That's pretty awesome.
Like vocals, I sang on it and played a saxophone solo. Yeah, it's great. I don't even know where it is. That's a great question. It's gotta be around somewhere. I know it's not gone. He wouldn't have gotten rid
of it.
That's
amazing.
But yeah.
Were you singing a blues?
Yeah, I wrote words and
you wrote words
lyrics
and took solos between your verses.
Yeah, I took a solo on it.
Good.
I think maybe my dad did
right
too
now.
Or something like that.
Yeah. That sounds awesome.
That's amazing. Do you guys prefer playing live, or you prefer being in the studio?
Oh, I love them both.
Well, it's two very, very
different
things.
Yeah, I just love them both.
Yeah. You don't really have to choose.
You know,
they're just wildly different. Mm-hmm. Live, I'll play a lot louder. than I ever play in the studio. Like microphones, I've never played as loud as I will outside at a festival. And I've never played that loud in the studio. I'm trying to think if I've ever had a chance to play as loud as I can, like in the studio, probably not.
I've done it by design. Yeah. Like I've set up like a mic in a hallway or like very distantly and then just like screamed through the instrument from a different room just to get the energy but not the response, you know, like of the mic being close on it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't think I play that loud to begin with, you know? So like, especially if you're a trumpet players tend to play pretty loud, you know? Mm-hmm. But when I was learning to play, my sister was always, she hated hearing me practice. She lived upstairs and I had like a kind of a basement room. And so I think I figured out that that's wise because I would have to play so quietly to not wake her up so she didn't actually know.
Wow.
You know.
That's interesting.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, you have to learn how to play soft. That's the whole thing.
And I can get a lot more character out of playing softly than if I'm playing loud, it just maxes it all out and, you know.
What's an album or a take or a horn sound that sounds perfect to you guys? Like sets a standard in your mind for like an amazing recording?
That's tough.
Yeah.
A lot of different ones.
Yeah, I'm sure. I'm sure there are a ton.
I mean, the Rocky soundtrack was one of my big things that I loved. I would check that CD out from the library and listen to those brass players. I always thought that Bill Conti stuff was amazing. And then what else did I check out? I would check out lots of soundtracks. Superman soundtrack, Indiana Jones soundtrack, and then I think Earth, Wind & Fire's horn sound. Oh, yeah. In my opinion, the greatest brass section in the history of music, the Phoenix Brass.
Do you still feel that way now about Earth, Wind & Fire?
That they're the greatest brass section? Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah,
I'll go with that.
I'm trying to think of one better.
And, oh man!
Yeah,
you know, at me.
Yeah, yeah.
Everybody fired. Greatest brass section.
Yeah. What about you, Stewart?
Oh man! I mean, the first CDs I ever went and bought, it was like Warehouse Records back when that existed.
Yeah.
And they had the long box, and I bought Kinda Blue by Miles, and I bought Blue Light, Red Light by Harry Connick Jr. And Pearl Jam's 10, which obviously didn't have any horns on it.
I was like, I don't know the horn section on that Pearl Jam record.
No, not so much. But I bought them at the same time. And I went and I just ate that up. Then later with Kinda Blue, that whole, like, everything was so dark and velvety.
Mm-hmm.
Every note was sung. So Miles was playing on that mute. And that mute often records really bright and tinny. Like, you can't just stick a normal condenser mic in front of a Harman mute and get the sound like anything. So there, you know, but like everything, the sax solos, the, you know, Coltrane and Cannonball playing on that was just like, yeah, that was Osmosis. I just loved that, ate it up. And then the Harry Connick Jr. record is incredible.
Oh, the arrangements, the brass players,
all that particular, that's his best record that I've ever heard. Yeah. And I'm not a huge fan, but that record, the big band, sounds unbelievable. And it was Roger Ingram playing lead trumpet, I believe.
Ooh, yeah.
Who then later, when I was 16, and I went to Marsalis, came to town with the Lincoln Center Jazz Orchestra and did his Blood on the Fields, his operetta about slavery that won him a Pulitzer Prize. And Roger Ingram was playing lead trumpet in that too. And that band, the brass blend was unbelievable.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
They didn't overdo it. There was three of each too. It was like three trumpets, three bones, maybe four saxes. Huh. It was just so thick, so dark.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, we have trombone. Brad, tell us about the mic setup we have.
So we've got the Spirit up close. It's in figure eight to get a little bit of the room. Mm-hmm. And then we've got the Starlights in a pair, an XY pair, at the back, a little further away.
Right.
With the vintage setting.
Gotcha. So you're gonna get a bunch of air from the room, and then you're gonna also get the direct from up front.
Yep.
Awesome. Well, cool. Look forward to hearing it. Let's hear it.
Sweet. Thank you.
So what's something non-musical that's made you a better player?
I would say for me, it was my mom teaching me how to cook was one. Just like learning how to relax and pay attention. Don't leave the room. You know, one thing at a time, and like take some care in what you're doing. And I would also say with sports too, which is like the idea of like you are no good, and this guy is way better than you, so you better practice. Because like it's just a different way of talking to each other. Like, you know, artists have different ways. Oh, you're gonna make it. You're gonna get it. And like sports is just like you're gonna not play. You're gonna sit on the bench and not play unless you get better. It's up to you. You need to run more. You need to lift more weights. Yeah. You need to learn the plays.
And it's no like, wonder I didn't play more sports.
Yeah, so like, yeah, sports is definitely like gets you used to learning how to learn and being okay with like sucking real bad until you figure it out, you know?
Mm. Yeah.
So, that was cool.
Yeah, no, that's good.
For me, I think learning how to be a better, like, listener, like almost just on a level of just like student of humanity or something, you know what I mean? Just like figuring out, I mean, I was an only child, so that was a real struggle for me for a while, like was figuring out how to exist in a social context and like, you know, and I was so sure I had this great way of doing anything, you know what I mean? Because that's what you do when you're alone, is you figure it out.
You just do
a bunch of shit by yourself and you come up with these ways that you think are so cool. And so yeah, at points at which I had opportunities and started to realize that like everybody's got something they like, you know, like that they really like, some way of doing something or something they're really genuinely interested in, you know, like I think just trying to meet people where they live and be a good listener and take on those inspirations, you know, I don't know.
Yeah, no, that's great. Mm-hmm.
We keep going in order.
Yeah.
I just happened to sit this way, but. Yeah. Hey, that was good. I think empathy. Like I'm a fairly sensitive person, I've been told, you know, and if I
I've been told.
But you know, really feeling like what people are experiencing, like I can really feel that, you know? And even if I don't agree with them, I can kind of, you know, try to see how they are seeing it or how they're feeling it. And as horns, you know, we're decorative usually, you know? Yeah. Something that you put on top or in response or whatever. So, and also the way that I play usually, or at least what I'm stronger at, I think, you know, is more in the colors, you know? Mm-hmm. So I think by really absorbing and feeling everything, like I actually can use that. So then when I'm, you know, like when I'm playing a whole set of music with somebody's music that I don't know, and it's actually can be kind of my wheelhouse, you know, because I can process that stuff pretty quickly, as long as it's not too complicated harmonically, where I have to think about it a lot, you know?
Yeah, I think that's just good to know and good to hear players talk about it, because a lot of people think it's all about the notes and think it's all about the technique. And a lot of times it's stuff like, that's like the price of entry, but all this other stuff is like what elevates someone's playing, you know, whatever it is, you know.
That's so fascinating.
Fundamental stuff is very important. I think like sometimes it gets lost in the wash when people do start kind of talking like that when they aren't good though. Mm-hmm. Like you need, like being how you are, and I guess we're all kind of like how you described, as sensitive and keeping track of things. And sometimes the just boringness of scale work, learning how to actually
play. That's something we haven't covered, man. But yeah, just to be able to get horns on a level. Not so much saxophone, I think.
I think it's a little easier,
Yeah, you can just like slump over and you
kind of like pull it over to the side and just
brass. That's like, you know, playing brass, man. You got to do a whole bunch of boring just to kind of like be at zero. And that, getting that to not, you know, make you so frustrated you still want to play.
A perfect example is when you're in high school. Mm-hmm. If you're in high school, you can learn how to play a Weezer song on a guitar. But a high school kid can barely play anything on a brass instrument. They can barely they're playing hot cross buns and struggling, let alone trying. Then you're trying to like play with a guitar player and they're playing in the key of E or A or D and like, I don't know my E scale. You know, it's like, I only know the B flat scale.
It's literally a tritone away from where my horn
is. Yeah, it's the worst scale to learn to try to play with the guitar players. But I think, there's a lot to it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, it's a physical instrument, which, I mean, like just to be able to produce a sound. You know, some people are just gifted. They can, they can play jazz, classical, whatever, and, you know.
No biggie.
No biggie, but long tones and flexibilities and that. Oh my God, so much boring
lots
stuff.
And lots and lots of time.
Yeah, mm-hmm. You can cut all that out because it really is like, it's a drag. You
know? Yeah, no, don't cut it out. Don't cut it out.
Long and misanswered.
Fun setup, looks like. We have, you're going through an effects pedal board.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to give us a vague idea of the kind of effects you're using?
I've got some pitch shifters. I have the, trying the Mellotron thing out, which is kind of cool, a couple settings. And then those are electro-harmonics type things, the Mellotron. I've got an Empress delay echo system. This Eventide mixing link is how I get, microphones into the pedals.
So it's like a reamp kind
of thing. It's basically a reamp. You know, not everybody likes it. You can't just put a mic straight into pedals, but I don't know, I like it.
And Brad, on the microphones we have the Aston Starlight is getting his dry signal and throwing it through two bass amps.
Mm-hmm. That's going into all his pedals from the Starlight.
Okay, so it's going Starlight on which setting?
It's the modern setting.
On the modern setting, but the sound's getting colored by the pedal board, so we're going Starlight into the pedal board into two bass amps, and then those are being mic'd by two Aston Origins. And then we have an Aston Spirit on cardioid to just get the dry room sound, natural horn sound. And it's, I mean, how far away is this, do you think? Like, how far away do you usually like to be when you're doing this kind of thing?
Me?
Yeah.
I mean, that looks pretty good.
It might be a little closer than normal, but
could be. It depends on the room too. Sometimes.
When you're doing the effects thing to color it too, you want to get in closer.
I've usually put the effects mic pretty close.
Yeah.
You know, to kind of cut down on what else it might be listening to.
Right.
But
that's kind of cool because you could sort of mix yourself almost with.
Yeah, which is good. What I do anyway, because I play really dynamically, so.
Right.
I don't like it when front of house is turning me way down. I'd rather the left.
Right.
High,
like you can be emotive with.
Then I can back off. And,
yeah. Very cool. Let's see what it sounds like.
Cool.
Thank you.
Stop for a second, need some olive oil.